Welcome back to episode 2 of Conquest TV, your free video guide to Warhammer 40,000 Conquest. In this video, we'll be looking at everything you'll find in issues 3 and 4 of your magazine. We'll be using all of the new models and paints from these issues to reinforce your armies and to take our paint jobs even further. We'll also play a couple of games where we'll learn how to send our warriors charging towards the enemy to fight in close combat, as well as how to organize our fighters into squads ready for battle. As ever, make sure your magazines are nearby. You'll want them close to hand as you build, paint, and play with your new models. Within issues 3 and 4 of Conquest, you'll find loads of new details about the Space Marines and Death Guard. There's a profile of the Reavers, the sinister, skull-masked shock troops of the Space Marines, and a detailed breakdown of their war gear, including cool details about their high-powered heavy bolt pistols and combat knives, which they use to cut their enemies down in close combat. The Reavers are at the cutting edge of the Space Marines' close support units. By the time you've read through issue 3, you'll know everything you need to about their place within the armies of the Imperium. There's also an epic account of the Battle of Taravar, where a unit of Reavers from the Raven Guard chapter infiltrated an alien Necron tomb complex and destroyed it, winning a war through stealth and guile, the Raven Guard way. It's not all about the Space Marines though. In fact, issue 4 is loaded with information about the followers of Nurgle. You've also got a profile of the Poxwalkers, unfortunate humans who've been infected by one of Nurgle's plagues and shamble alongside the Death Guard into battle. And there's an awesome gallery of color schemes for different Death Guard warbands, known as Vectoriums, and each example tells you a little bit about who they are and how they fight. From the Putrid Choir to the Weeping Legion, there's sure to be something to inspire your own Death Guard collection. Grab your clippers, it's time to add new recruits to your forces. Between issues 3 and 4, you've got two sets of models to build, Space Marine Reavers and Death Guard Poxwalkers. Let's start with the Reavers. Get your sprue of Reavers and take a look at them. Like the Intercessors and Death Guard last time, each Reaver comes in several parts. Parts 1 to 6 make up Reaver Palon, 7 to 12 are for Sergeant Castius, and with parts 13 to 18, you'll make Reaver Atreus. The Reavers are built in much the same way as the Intercessors were. For each one, you'll want to clip out the 6 components: the front and back of the body, the head, the power pack, and both arms. Following the guide in issue 3, build each model by slotting its head into the front of its body and then pushing the back into place. Using the pegs on the body as guides, add each arm and the model's power pack to finish it. Do this for each of the 3 models, and congratulations! Your Ultramarine army now has a new unit. The Death Guard Plague Marines we made in the last installment don't stand a chance against the combined might of the Intercessors and the Reavers, so they should probably get some reinforcements as well. Enter the Poxwalkers you've got from issue 4. You'll notice that the Poxwalkers come in fewer parts than the models you built last time. 3 of them are just a single part that only needs to be slotted into their base, the easiest models you've built yet. The other 3 are each made up of 2 or 3 parts that just need to be clipped out and pushed together. Build your Poxwalkers and you'll be ready to move on to painting your new units. Your new issues have also added 2 new paints to your collection. Issue 3 includes Lead Belcher, which is a dark silver colour usually used for weapons like knives or the barrels of guns, and issue 4 comes with Bugman's Glow, which is the perfect base coat for flesh. You'll be using both of these and your other 4 paints to get your new recruits ready for battle. So get them all out where you can use them, along with your brush, clean water, and some kitchen towel, and let's get ready to paint. If you look at the painting guide in issue 3, you'll notice that how you paint the Reavers is really similar to how you painted your Intercessors last time. So how about a quick refresher on how you did that? Remember to wash out your brush after each colour and bring it back to a fine point, and to change your water regularly. Paint your Reavers all over with Macragge Blue. Remember to add a little water to the paint and apply it thinly with even brush strokes so you don't obscure the detail. While each model is drying, you can base coat the next one. And when it's done, it should look like this. By the time you've got all 3 covered in Macragge Blue, the first one should be just about ready for the next colour. The Reavers wear lighter armour than the Intercessors, with more ribbed cables on show, and have more pouches, so there's more Abaddon Black to add. Don't forget to paint their heavy bolt pistols and the scabbards for their combat knives. The Reaver Sergeant has a bare head, so you'll want to paint his hair black as well. Now, once you've added the Abaddon Black to your Reavers, it should look like this. It's also a good idea to clean out your water after this, as it's probably getting a little dirty and you'll want to clean it for a good finish on the gold and silver that are coming next. The Reavers are stealthy infiltrators, so their armour is less ornate and decorated than the Intercessors. But gold is still an important colour for them, as it marks their loyalty to the chapter's second company. Their left shoulder pads, chest icons, and the hilt of their combat knives should be gold, as well as the detailing on the scabbards. Now, once you've done it, and you've added the Retributor armour, it should look like this. Now you get to crack open one of your new colours, Leadbelcher. This metal should be used on areas of the Reavers that would be made of metal. Their combat knives and the barrels, clips and butts of their pistols are the obvious areas. As well as those, their grenades and the vents on their power packs will look great painted in Leadbelcher to form a strong contrast with the blue and black on the models. Now, remember to refer to the magazine if you want to see what these should look like. When you've finished painting with the Leadbelcher onto your Reaver, it should look something like this. The Reaver Sergeant's bare head is perfect for adding some Bugman's glow. With a fine point on your brush, paint the skin between his hairline and the mask that covers his nose and mouth. If you get any paint on those other details, you can always paint over it in the original colour after the Bugman's glow has dried. Now, when you're finished, it should look like this. This is a great time to go back and add Leadbelcher and Bugman's glow to your Intercessors as well. You'll find a guide to what details to paint in each colour in issues 3 and 4. Their bolt rifles, power pack vents, and some other details like Gallius Scanner will look great in Leadbelcher. And Sergeant Destia's skin will really pop when it's been painted with Bugman's glow. Painting the Poxwalkers is a bit different to the other units you've done so far. They don't have large areas of armour like the Space Marines and Plague Marines, and they're the first of your models to use all 6 of your paints. Here's how to get them looking great. Like the Plague Marines last time, you want to base coat your Poxwalkers with Death Guard Green. In this case, it represents their diseased and rotten flesh. Now, there's a lot of detail on the Poxwalkers, so it's especially important to thin the paint before applying it. The mutated Poxwalkers have so many warts, pustules, tentacles and growths all over their bodies that will look great painted in Bugman's glow. Look carefully at each model and decide which parts you want to be in this colour. Then neatly paint them. With things like tentacles, it might not be clear where the mutation ends and flesh begins. This is a chance to make your models your own and choose for yourself where you want each colour to end. Remember that if you go over the bits you'd like to have in green, you can always paint Death Guard Green back over them when the Bugman's glow is dry. When you've added the Bugman's glow, it should look something like this. Like the Space Marines, you should paint pouches with Abaddon Black, along with boots for those that have them, but there are a bunch of other details that it's a good idea to paint black too. In these cases, the black will act as a primer for Leadbelcher, which looks better over black than over Death Guard Green, or for other colours that you'll get in future issues, like bone for horns. So once you've painted with the Abaddon Black, it should look like this. Several of the Poxwalkers are carrying crude weapons like lengths of pipe and axes. Paint the parts of these that would be metal with Leadbelcher. Some of them have chainmail as well, which will look fantastic in silver. Once you've added Leadbelcher, it should look like this. There's not much gold on the Poxwalkers, but small details like charms and Nurgle runes or spikes on weapons will look great and really draw the eye. This is an example of what I mean. Many of the Poxwalkers used to be soldiers or workers in Ultramar, the realm of space ruled by the Ultramarines. Because of this, they have scraps of cloth in blue, a popular colour in that area. So pick these out with Macragge Blue to finish off your Poxwalkers for now. We'll go back to them in future when you have more paints. But in the meantime, this is what it should look like with the Macragge Blue added. Right now though, just like we did with the Intercessors, you can go back to the Plague Marines and add details in Leadbelcher and Bugman's Glow to these models as well. You can see what parts use these colours in the painting sections of issues 3 and 4. And trust me, the mutant mouth on Repugnus looks incredible once you paint it with Bugman's Glow. Now that you have four awesome looking units, it's time to wage war. This episode, we're going to play two separate battles, with each one looking at a new part of the rules. Our first game is outlined in issue 3 and deals with how to get your warriors fighting in deadly close combat. It's called Blade to Blade. To set up the game, gather up everything you're going to need. That's your game mat, dice, range rulers, and an objective marker. And of course, your warriors. In this game, the Ultramarines and Death Guard are locked in battle aboard the strike cruiser Honor of Ultramar, with both sides deploying reserves to break the stalemate. For this battle, you'll need your three new Reaver models and your three Plague Marines. Place your models on the deployment points on the map, as shown in your issue, grab a friend to play with, and you're ready for battle. Just like last time, in this game, each player's turn has a movement phase and a shooting phase. And now, we're adding two new phases to the game, charge and fight. These four phases make up a turn, and when both players have had a turn, it's called a battle round. In this game, the Ultramarines go first, so the full battle round looks like this. When both players have taken their turns, start a new battle round. If one player's models have all been removed from play, the player with the surviving models is the winner. One last thing before we begin. Remember last time as we played, we referred to the data sheets for our models in the magazine? Well, these are included in issue 3 as well. It's a good idea to keep this section of your magazine open in case you need to check anything as you play. Right, all set? Let's take a look at how a battle round works. In this battle, the Space Marine player goes first and starts by moving their models. You move your models one at a time and can move some, all, or none of them. To move a model, measure out how far they can go with their range ruler. Reavers are quite quick on their feet and can move 6 inches. When it's their turn to move, the Plague Marines can move 5 inches. All those hideous diseases must slow them down a fair bit. Ugh. So this Plague Marine is going to move 5 inches to here. Don't forget, just like before, warriors can advance if you want them to, although they won't be able to shoot this turn if they do. To advance, roll a dice, and whatever you roll, you can add that score to your model's move. So, for example, if I've already moved this Plague Marine 5 inches to here, if I want to advance, I can roll a dice, and I've rolled a 4, so that means I can move this Plague Marine another 4 inches forward. With the moving complete, it's time to open fire. Any of your models that didn't advance can shoot their weapons. Now, your models can shoot any enemy they can see. So first, check if they can spot a target by drawing an imaginary line between them and their foe. Don't forget, crates and containers will block your shots if they're in the way. This Reaver has got a clear shot at the Plague Marine, no crates or containers in the way, so he's clear to make the shot. Reavers have a ballistic skill of 3+. So roll a dice on a 3, 4, 5, or 6, and the shot is a hit. If the shot hits, you'll need to see if it has any impact, so make a wound roll. You'll need to score a 5 or a 6 to wound a Plague Marine with your heavy bolt pistols. If you succeed, the Plague Marine is going to need to take a saving throw. Although their armor is repulsive, it's still effective. If a Plague Marine is wounded, you'll need to roll a 3, 4, 5, or 6 to save the damage. Don't forget though, Plague Marines are disgustingly resilient. This means they get a bonus saving roll if they fail their armor save. So roll again. On a 5 or 6, their hideous mutations absorb the damage. If the roll is failed, the model suffers a wound and is removed from play. See ya. Shooting back at the Reavers works in much the same way. Plague Marines will score hits with their bolt guns on a 3, 4, 5, or 6, and if successful, will wound them on a 4, 5, or 6. If a Reaver is wounded, you'll need to roll a 3 or more for their armor to save the wound. Just like our intercessors last time, Reavers need to be wounded twice before they're removed from play. Sound a bit complicated? Don't panic. It's all explained clearly on the data sheets in your magazine, so you can refer back to them as you play. Once you've played a few battle rounds, it'll become second nature. So with moving and shooting out of the way, it's time to introduce a new phase to our battle round, the charge phase. This is the part where our models hurl themselves across the battlefield and into a deadly brawl. In the charge phase, any model that didn't advance in the movement phase can try to charge an enemy and engage them in combat. To charge, choose one of your models and pick an enemy nearby. The enemy model must be within 12 inches of the charging model. Measure the distance between the models to see if you're in range. If there aren't any enemies within 12 inches, your model can't charge this turn. However, you don't have to be able to see your enemy to charge them. In fact, it can be safer if they charge their enemy out of hiding. If the model being charged can see your model, they get a chance to shoot them before they charge. This is called overwatch. To take an overwatch shot, the model must not already be within 1 inch of an enemy. If they are, they're too busy fighting for their life to shoot someone else. Shooting a charging model is hard. So hard, in fact, that overwatch shots only hit on a roll of 6. If they hit, roll to wound and make saves just like you do in the shooting phase. If the charging model survives, they can try to close the distance to their enemy and fight. To see how far a model can charge, roll 2 dice and add the results together. If moving this far will get them within 1 inch of their target, the charge succeeds. If not, the charge fails and the model doesn't move at all. Remember that charging models have to move around containers and crates just like in the movement phase. So let's see if this Plague Marine can make a charge at this Reaver. Let's see if he's in range first. Yes, he is. So that means I can make a roll. Well, that's good enough. So I'm going to move the Plague Marine here, and he has successfully made his charge. He is in. The charge phase is the only time that a model can move within 1 inch of an enemy model. With all your charges completed, it's time to fight. In the fight phase, any model that's within 1 inch of an enemy gets to attack in close combat. Once a model is within 1 inch of an enemy, it can't move, shoot, or try to charge anyone else. They're far too busy fighting. It also can't be shot at. The risk of friendly fire is too high. When a model fights in close combat, it makes a number of attacks equal to its attack's characteristic. In the case of a Reaver, this is 2, so you get to roll 2 dice to try and hit the enemy. Hitting works in the same way as for shooting, except you use the model's weapon skill, or WS, instead of their ballistic skill. A Reaver has a weapon skill of 3+, so the dice needs to score 3, 4, 5, or 6 to hit. For each successful dice roll, you'll need to roll to wound, just as with shooting. A Reaver will need to score a 5 or 6 to wound a Plague Marine with his combat knife. If any Plague Marines are wounded, they get to make an armor save just like they do against shooting attacks. Their power armor saves them on a 3, 4, 5 or 6, and if the save has failed, there's a chance that they'll pass their disgustingly resilient saving throw of 5 or 6. Any Plague Marine who fails both of these saves is removed from play. Plague Marines fight back in much the same way. They have one attack on their profile, so roll 1 dice to attack in close combat. They'll hit their enemy on a 3, 4, 5 or 6, and if successful, will wound a Reaver on a 4, 5 or 6. Reaver's armor will save against close combat attacks on a 3, 4, 5 or 6. Any Reaver who suffers 2 wounds in battle is removed from play. If a model with more than 1 attack is fighting multiple enemies, they can split them up as they choose, but must decide before rolling any dice. In the fight phase, any models who charged this turn get to fight first. If multiple models charged, their player chooses the order they fight in. After all charging models have fought, the player whose turn it is can choose another of their models that hasn't fought yet and resolve their attacks. Then their opponent can do the same. Continue this until all fighting models have attacked or are dead. And yes, by the way, this means that models can fight in close combat in their opponent's turn. When a model defeats the last enemy within 1 inch of it, it can make a consolidation move. This is a free move of up to 3 inches in any direction. But remember that because it's not the charge phase, they can't move within 1 inch of an enemy model. So I'm going to move this Plague Marine another 3 inches forward, just there. And there we have it. Now that you know how to charge, fire overwatch and fight in close combat, play a few more turns with the full turn sequence to get used to them. If you want to add advanced rules to your close combat, check out issue 3 for special rules for Plague Knives, the Reaver's Combat Knives, and the massive power fist carried by Plague Champion Repugnus. This terrifying weapon makes it a bit harder to score a hit, but it can wound a Space Marine on a 2+. And if it does, the Space Marine doesn't get to make a save, as the power fist tears his armor apart. There are also rules for giving the game an exciting twist by turning it into a breakthrough mission. Try swapping forces so you can play the game from both perspectives. Up until now, you've been using each model as an individual. But on the battlefields of the 41st millennium, it's safer to fight as a team. So most warriors band together into squads of sworn comrades. In Warhammer 40,000, we call these units. In a game, all of the models in a unit stay together for the whole game, moving, shooting, and charging together, and fighting at the same time. In our second game, we're going to introduce these units and how they work. So gather your mat, your rulers, your objectives, dice, and your data sheets together, and let's get started. For this game, we'll be deploying our models in their units. Each set of models you have so far is a unit, and that means that your Space Marine Army consists of two units. One made up of three Intercessors, and one of three Reavers. The Death Guard Army also has two units. One's made up of three Plague Marines, and the other one is made up of six Poxwalkers. When a unit is set up at the start of the game, every model in the unit has to be placed on the gaming map within 2 inches of at least one other member of the unit. When a unit moves, advances, charges, or consolidates, all the models in the unit must end that move within 2 inches of at least one other member of the unit. You might hear this referred to as unit coherency. As you've not yet used the Poxwalkers, it's probably worth taking a minute to get to know them. You'll find their characteristics and abilities in issue 4 alongside a recap of the characteristics for your other units. Now you'll see that Poxwalkers are neither as strong nor as tough as Plague Marines, so it's easier for the Space Marines to wound them. They also don't have any ranged weapons, so they can't fire in the shooting phase. The Poxwalkers also don't wear armor, so they don't get a save, but don't count them out of the fight. Poxwalkers have the same disgustingly resilient rule as Plague Marines, so they ignore wounds on a roll of 5 or 6. They also have an awesome ability called Curse of the Walking Pox. Anytime an enemy model is taken out of action by a Poxwalker in the fight phase, you can add a model to their unit. This represents their fallen foes succumbing to the curse and joining their ranks. When a unit shoots, they all fire at the same target unit as their leader orders them to deal with the biggest threat. If you have several models shooting with the same weapons, like Intercessors with their bolt rifles, you can roll all the dice to hit and wound at once, rather than one at a time. If a unit is firing different weapons, like the Plague Marines, who each have a unique ranged weapon, you must roll to hit and to wound for each one separately. When a unit takes wounds, its owning player can choose which models to remove. If a unit has more than one wound per model, wounds must be put on one model until it's removed. Then a second model can be wounded. A unit can charge as long as one model from the unit is within 12 inches of the enemy. Of course, since the whole unit is charging, the whole enemy unit gets to fire Overwatch. Any models that can see, anyway. When moving charging models, the charge is successful as long as one model ends up within 1 inch of an enemy model from the unit being charged. Don't worry if some models from the unit don't end up within 1 inch, though. They will get their chance soon enough. When a unit is picked to fight in the fight phase, before they activate, any models not within 1 inch of an enemy can pile in. To do this, they can move up to 3 inches, but they have to end that move closer to the nearest enemy model. If they get within 1 inch of an enemy, they can fight this turn. Like with shooting, you can roll all your hit, wound, and save rolls at once, unless there are different close combat weapons being used. For the units you have, this only applies to the Plague Marines and their champion's Power Fist. Remember to roll for it separately from the Plague Knives. When a unit consolidates, all its models can move up to 3 inches. Now it's time to bring everything you've learned together and get all four of your units onto the gaming mat as you fight the battle for the cruiser. The fight to control the stricken cruiser, Honor of Ultramar, has reached its peak. Victory will go to the side who can control the critical react events or destroy their foe entirely. To deploy your forces, make a roll-off. Both players roll a dice, with the highest scorer placing one of their units. To do this, position one of the models in the unit on one of the deployment points, and then place all of the other models in the unit so that none of them are more than 2 inches away from at least one other model in the unit, and also no more than 4 inches from one of your deployment points. The other player now deploys one of their units in the same way, taking it in turns deploying units until they're all on the mat and ready for battle. In this mission, each force is trying to capture an objective from their enemies while defending their own. You can either win by wiping out the enemy force or by scoring more victory points. Every complete enemy unit you remove from play is worth 1 victory point, while controlling the objective marker is worth 3. The game lasts for 5 battle rounds, or until one side is wiped out. And there we have it. We've learned more about the Warriors in our growing Warhammer 40,000 collection, painted our new miniatures, and taken our games to the next level. We'll be back soon with another video covering issues 5 and 6 of Warhammer 40,000 Conquest. In these issues, we'll be adding even more awesome models to our collection. Lieutenant Calcius for the Ultramarines Army in issue 5, and more Death Guard Plague Marines in issue 6. All this along with loads more collecting, building, painting, and gaming content. Issue 5 of Warhammer 40,000 Conquest is the only place you'll be able to get Lieutenant Calcius, and the only way to guarantee you can get issue 5 is to subscribe. As a subscriber, you'll get every issue delivered to your door for free, so go to the website to get started. Until next time, thanks for watching, I'll see you soon.